early so we can have more time to bid on things, right? All right, so today I want to give a lot of thanks to Mike and Stephen for research and drawings. Really helped out a lot. So today, the Carson Yards, the main yards, right here, right over there. So on this, you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see, Carson Street right here, and Highway 50 right here, Mills Park here, and this is where the yards were once upon a time. So 1869 is when they started out. They had the golden spike, the first spike here. By the end of 1869, it built all the way up to Gold Hill and were running trains in regular operation. We've got the track here for down Caroline Street. So here we're looking north. This will be Carson Street here. And let's see, this one right across the top here is Williams. So that'll be Highway 50 eventually. Washington Street, the tracks end right here, right around Carson Street. They won't go down Washington Street for another couple of years. Somewhere in here, there's going to be a telegraph house for the dispatcher, the main dispatcher. But no idea where that was. If they're in one of these hotels here or something, or had an office, one of these buildings is their office, or what.
Excuse me.
Yes?
If you put the microphone on your other collar, it might work.
Up here? Have to be smarter than microphone. I'm
excellent.
Failing. Thank you. Okay, around 1871, the tracks go down Stewart Street, down to the Clear Creek Flume. There's a newspaper article in 1870 that said they've started, and one in 1873 that said they're done. Probably didn't take them 3 years to build that. But before then, all of the wood is coming from the yards up here and off of Ash Creek. As we finally punched through the tracks here down Washington Street, connecting up with Reno. The freight house here gets moved in from Steamboat, and we build the first passenger depot. And there's a little sleeper track here for the Central Pacific sleeper cars, because they don't want to take them up to Virginia City yet. Let's see. Oh, yeah, and we start building the roundhouse. The engine house. The not roundhouse.
Rectangular
house. The square house.
Rectangular
house. U-shaped.
The horseshoe. 1873, the roundhouse, engine house is complete. Got the turntable in there. And they've covered the creek here, which across from the passenger depot, which they say is a great improvement. They don't have people falling into the creek while they're waiting for the train anymore. Uh, 1874, we get the Carson and Tahoe Lumber and Fluming office here, the valuation office, and they put some wooden sidewalks in here going around. What else? We have the boiler house and the passenger depot, which takes a little bit longer.
Curtis, what is the building that's north of the passenger depot down?
This one right here? On the Sanborns, it shows up as the Armory Hall. They used it for dances and things.
And then just north of there, is that the start of some of this, the extra buildings?
Right up here?
Not that far.
Right up here? No, those are just
buildings.
Random buildings. Saloons and offices and houses and stores and whatnot. Any other questions? Now, this one up here would be the gas works.
What is the building down in the corner?
Right here?
No, no, down the corner.
Below that right-hand corner.
The blow-up.
Right here?
Below.
This one?
Yeah.
This is the boiler house.
Okay.
This is a close-up of the boiler house right up, here. I'm sorry.
Definitely a question, Chris.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No water tank?
The water tank was down Ash Creek. There was a little flume coming out there, and that's where the water tank was initially. At some point in time, they do get a water tank here. It shows up in the 1875 drawing. So, and in the drawing, it looks very similar to what they put in at Reno. But I don't know exactly when that went in. It might have gone in as early as 72 when they put in the line to Reno also. But it's not the tank that you see in most of the photographs. That comes in a little bit later. Here we get the material yards out the back of the horseshoe house. Some of the foundry buildings coming in, the sand house, the paint shop, with one of the grill cars getting painted. These right here are just some miscellaneous buildings that show up in one of the earlier photo, in the 1890 photo of the depot, taken from the Mint. No idea what they are, but they're gone by the valuation survey. 1877, the paint shop, get a little shed in the back. There's a note about more material yards, and so I'm guessing that they're starting to flush out this area here north of the depot. They're nice little outhouses over the ditch here for sanitation.
Running water.
Self-flushing, self-cleaning.
Yeah.
1882, so the Ormsby is in the shop boiler now. They put some bracing on the back of the paint shop so it doesn't fall over. Add a wheel grinding shed, which is unfortunately here behind the wall here on the in the courtyard. We get the oil house right here. And they replaced the water tower with the more familiar double kind of slanted one.
Curtis, was there only two tracks there in the yard? Two-yard track?
Don't know.
Okay. Seems like there were more than that.
There are later, definitely. And they come and go. In 98, I think they had a bunch for the fight. And then they take them all out again, almost all of them out again.
Okay.
But then there's a bunch more by the time they do the survey, which... Mm-hmm. You know, maybe those came in as part of the Tonopah boom, so they could have a place to stick all these cars they couldn't move.
Yeah,
they were taxed on how much track they had, so they would... Sorry?
Is that the white line of the track? Is that a road?
This is a ditch here, so... Yeah.
Because in earlier slides, it was a different position.
Right. Let's back up here. And I don't know when that changed. Here we go. So the 1875 drawing, they've got the ditch here coming along this side of the tracks, right? But by the time you have the valuation survey, they've moved the ditch in along here. The stream, right? Ash Canyon Creek.
Hey, Curtis, you said Ormsby is now the boiler.
Yeah.
Shop boiler. I'm sorry. Can you explain what you mean?
Well, so they have a boiler to power all the machinery, right? And for a little while, they're using one of the old locomotives as that boiler to run the shops. I think it's parked up here on one of these tracks.
As opposed to what, it was up at BC?
Well, it was running before then. It was a locomotive that they were...
The engine
Ormsby is out of service and is now a stationary boiler for the yards.
I think they took it off of the frame and put it in the shop.
They put it in the shop here?
Yeah.
Could be. I stuck, in later times, the boiler shop here has a kind of a shed on the back. And so the earlier model here of that, I just had a regular building and I put the shed on the back here, so.
There's a double track curving downward to the bottom of the picture, and there's a structure at the end of the track. What is that?
It shows up as an ice house in the survey. It's also on some of the earlier sandboards. By the 41 sandboard, I think it's gone. Okay, 91. So here we start painting the rose green. Before that, we're using kind of a mineral red on the walls and roofs of most of the buildings that weren't yellow or ochre. Derrick House gets a little shed on the back. '97, '98. So here we had a bunch of track for the Corbett fight, almost 6,000 feet of track. And so I just kind of crammed it in where I could again. Presumably it was something maybe similar.
They needed that one.
What's that?
They needed that one.
Because so many people were coming into town for the fight.
They need more track.
Yeah, to store all the passenger cars and coaches. So, you know, that was pretty much the only way to get into town, right? And this was a big deal. They added track here, they added track in Steamboat. Where else?
Yeah.
Anywhere they had spare land, I think, right, Stephen?
The people who came had to live on the cars because there weren't enough hotel rooms in town.
The freight depot here shows an extension on the sandboard maps. Don't know if that was added here for the fight or for the Tonopah boom, but those are two guesses of when and or why that was extended. By the end of 1897, though, all that track was gone, except for 900 feet. 1904, we get a little coal hoist from the Southern Pacific. Get a little coal yard there. And this is where I started putting in the tracks, the yard tracks here that show up in the evaluation survey. Theorizing that maybe around 1900 when the Tonopah boom started, right? When they had all sorts of traffic stacked up for the narrow gauge interchange at Mount House.
Curtis, any idea what the two spurs southwest of the water tank are?
This one right here?
No, southwest.
Over here.
Are those two?
No. They also show up in some of the, or in the evaluation survey. In 1875 drawing, it looks like some of they are sidings that come across all the way over here.
I think they were cut off, made stubs, yeah, when the track...
Right, when this track comes in here, okay. When they put in the Minden Bridge, because you see that it cuts off right there. So that may change. Yeah, I may have cut those off a little bit early there. So 1905, let's see, we get a flanger house right up here. It's a little shed here. And they start building the Minden Branch. And so those other little buildings that were around here, I think those go away at this time when they put the track through. In 1906, they've actually finished the track. Get the oil tank right here on the south of the square house. And there was some, a couple slides back I missed. They had some cribbing here and put a narrow gauge track in here so they can run narrow gauge engines out here on the flat car. Offload them off the flat car onto the raised track and pull them into the yard for repairs. Mid-1880s, I think, somewhere around there.
Early 80s.
I think it was an 1882 photo that doesn't show it, and then later ones that do. Of course, by now, the SP is standard gauged, the old cars in Colorado, and so there aren't as many narrow gauge locomotives around. Next year, they add a little bit more capacity to the oil tank, and this in-ground tank here, double the storage. 1910, now we start changing colors again, so we're painting the robes red again. By now, we're probably to a lighter caboose red. And we get the McKean car. McKean car gets its own house. In 1911, Carson Street gets paved, at least a little bit of it, several miles, probably up to the depot at least. I'm not entirely sure how much further past that they paved. And the paint shop, which was before painted in passenger colors, is now red, like all of the other utility buildings. 1917, the next motor car, 23, gets its own house. It's not as fancy, a little bit smaller. They put a little three-way switch in here instead of the regular. This one just misses the valuation study. 1918, boxcar 109 gets put on the ground here, next to the tool house. 1925, we start having some turntable issues. Put a couple tracks more in on the south side off the switch here instead of coming through the turntable. Sometime around now, we probably get this Shell Oil facility. What's the date on the siding down Stewart Street? 23, maybe? Sorry. 36. Now we start closing buildings down. The paint shop's closed. Express Car 2 gets put on the ground as a house. Right about there, it's still there. Inside an ever-expanding house. And the freight depot has Carson on the roof now, so the airplanes don't get lost. And they started painting those in 27, I think, and there's a building in Reno that gets painted about then. But 36, I think, was the earliest photo I found with the freight depot having it. And I think there was another push in 36 to get more buildings painted. So we're getting ready to shut down the Virginia City line. There's plenty of space in the roundhouse, the not roundhouse. And so I think the motor car 23 gets moved in here. And this gets turned into just a storage shed. They move the doors over to the other side, pull out the rails. There's a little shed on the back of the shed. And the valuation house here, the old Carson on top of the lumber and flooring office, loses its passenger colors now, sometime in the late 30s. The foundry closes. The Lakeview Tool House here gets It's moved on a flat from Lakeview down here to Carson. Stuck next to the building with many names, Car Whacker's House or the Car Repair House. The boxcar gets retrucked and sold. And the Mount House Depot comes for a visit. They raise that up a couple of feet and stick a truck dock around most of it. Sell the flanger shed here. And the Civic Auditorium gets built. So the building that was here burns down 36 or so. And they go without a dance hall for a couple of years and decide to build a new one. So that's still standing. That's the Children's Museum today. The motel right here now. The material yard here shows up on the Sanborn as a private lumber yard. They don't have any tracks going in here anymore. Highway 50 was paved a while back. The Dutch Mill coffee shop here, now Heidi's. You can see it's shaped like a windmill, right?
What is it originally?
And technically Heidi's is adjacent here, where the windmill is. Here is the parking lot now. Machine shops are retired. You know, a lot of the windows start getting boarded up here. McKean cars sold, sheds boarded up. Shops are officially retired again. We've lost the Minden branch here a couple years ago, 1940 maybe. Once Virginia City's gone, it's not a branch, it's the only line, so they don't need the extra spur there. 48, the turntable cemented and track, and they route a couple more tracks around on the north side. Maybe too many here. Hard to see, yeah. There's, they have one or two too many tracks here. Some of these were vacant.
Is that the Gold Coast on the spot?
Yeah, we've got Gold Coast here. I left off all the trees so you could actually see the buildings. By now, this is pretty well forested. And in 1950, it's done. Everything's pulled up. Rails are poured on. Turntables sold. Another couple of years, they'll punch Stewart Street through. And the buildings start disappearing. Freight House lasts into the 60s before it burns down. Valuation House here was 70s before they pulled it down. Any questions?
Well, basic one. So since early on there were two sets of tracks leaving west out of town, one went by the passenger depot, another by the freight depot. So two questions, where did they meet up again on the west? And then second of all, with the combination trains and the passenger depot, how they determined which track went down?
So the first part I can answer, there was another set of yards out about here, the original yards in Carson City. There was a little three-stall engine house here, a turntable, carpenter shop, and a sand coal house. And that's where the Caroline Street tracks curved back in to Washington Street and then went out to Sand Cut and to the flume out here. as to how they decided where to bring the trains in. All the pictures I've seen of mixed trains have been here at the passenger depot.
Early on with the accommodation train, they would cut the combine off on the hill, and by gravity it would come down to the passenger station, and the freight train would come into the freight station. The newspaper called that the ghost car coming down, and forced the railroad to put a bell on it so people wouldn't get run over.
So Carson had an early roller coaster.
Charlie, when you're saying the hill,
coming down from Lakeview. Yeah. Gravity wins again.
Yeah.
Curtis, what car mentioned the water, but this section seemed like the depot.
I don't know whether they ever did that. That was what the newspaper wanted.
Both depots were extended over the years. Early, the passenger depot was extended almost immediately. And then the freight depot was extended probably between 85 and 90, I think. There are two Sanborns, and the 85 shows it as short, and the 90 shows it as long. They added 50 feet on it, so it was about 100 feet long, had two doors, and so they tacked another 50 feet on, added a third door.
There was no depot before that.
So the first couple years before they built this one, I don't know what they had. They had something. I mean, they built passenger depots up in Virginia City. They had to be coming from somewhere.
They referred to depot grounds, or depot, right, platform.
But whether there was just a platform here, yeah, and they were using some of these existing hotels. And,
yeah, Central Pacific.
Yeah. And they had to have something for the dispatcher, because the main dispatcher was here in Carson before they built the general offices there.
Because as you explained to me, I thought maybe they actually had the depot other than the shack. Just made it up to it.
Yeah, so the initial depot here was built in 72, and I think 73 they extended it.
Yeah, but remember that the Gold Hill Depot before they completed the Reno line was just a platform, but they called it the depot.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No buildings.
And looking at Sanborn, well, and looking at railroad maps on all along the northwestern Pacific, every little town had a corral.
Mm-hmm.
Was there, because stock kept getting moved in and out. You know, everybody needed horses to get around, just like now we bring cars in. Was there any evidence? I've never noticed whether there was any evidence of a corral.
Oh, yeah.
There's the valuation survey shows them.
Turn that off.
It's me.
Shows a corral right here.
Okay.
In these drawings, I put it in with the Minden Branch coming in. It could have been there much earlier, and they could have had other things as well. Probably not before 72 when they connected to Reno. So they were probably just doing wood and ore.
Yeah.
And so the city library was the stop here.
I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Yeah. I was wondering if you had thought about it, but I have a map of Carson City, the obvious one that's printed and reprinted and whatever it is, and it looks as if the switch that comes off to the right of the station at one time had a siding there, and that's where they parked the Central Pacific sleeping car.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't looking, but I'm wondering, do that on earlier pictures?
Yes.
My back button is slow, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Oh, there you got it. Looks like.
No, that's the McKee.
No, that's the Minden spur.
Yeah.
You have it back on there, Curtis, I can move.
Sure.
But I was surprised, because I had read, you know, that the cars never went to Virginia City, then they had that picture of one of those Silver Palace cars up in Virginia City. And when I got a hold of that map, I was surprised to see that little sighting and a caricature of the car. Well, you do show it, yeah. It's kind of cool, though.
Yeah.
I think the car in the picture in Virginia was a private car.
Uh-huh.
Not a Central Pacific standard sleeper.
Oh, it was a private car?
Yeah. I know it was, but I don't think it was standard. It was up there for a charter.
They were parked by the CNC shafts.
You have the pie photo before the fire in Virginia City that shows Central Palace, Silver Palace car B, I think, sitting next to Combine 16.
Yeah.
And that is a Silver Palace car. It's one of the first two that they bought, and it was a little bit shorter than the later Silver Palace cars.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
But they didn't generally go up there. We're not sure why that particular one was up there.
They didn't like that trestle.
Maybe it was a test.
Okay. Yes, sir.
What do you know about the troubles in the 1950s after that last run, as far as the right-of-way lands that the B&C occupied?
Nothing.
Nothing. Okay. I was going to say, I once worked with a guy who was an engineering professor at the university, and but he'd also had some legal training. And what the B&T did, they hired him to supervise their end of that whole thing. And what they found is that they were public easements, you know, and the arrangements were made with the original owners or the owners at the time. And by the time the 1950s arrived, of course, they'd gone through a lot of deaths and sales, you know, various years and things like that. And I asked him, how did they finally decide who those lands belonged to? And he said he really didn't know. He worked for them for about a year. And he said he thinks that they simply reverted to, you know, the current owners, and they ignored all that stuff in the background. You know, who owned what, and who left what to his heirs, and all of that. But you don't know anything about that?
No. Okay. Bob Gray, I think, spent a couple years sorting all that out before to get his railroad up and running.
Yeah.
So where did you access the Sanborn maps and the valuation studies that you used for this at Carson City?
Sanborn maps are from UNR.
Okay.
And then the valuation survey, the maps are available from NSRM. I sell a DVD.
Sanborn.
Or did, I'm assuming they still do.
Sanborn's are available online.
The Department of Highways, I think, has an online version of the valuation maps also, but they're fairly low resolution. Not nearly as good as the ones on the DVD from NSRM.
To the extent that I could hear what you were saying, I'm absolutely in awe of this technique. What are your publication plans, if any?
None. I'll post it up on the website, probably, and so people can download it and look at it.
Thank you. I submit that with accompanying text to say the things that you said verbally and other items, it would make just a really neat publication.
Possibly. It's really good at pointing out what we don't know.
Is that bad?
Start for another presentation.
Where does the flume line go after it crosses here?
The ditch here?
No, the flume?
The flume.
Right, but isn't the one that went to Minden, the bridge, isn't that a flume line too?
Yes, in the early days before it goes down to Minden, it just goes out to the flume over where the Railroad Museum is, the Clear Creek Flume.
Oh, okay.
So it runs down Stewart Street to the Box Factory and it hangs a right, I think, and goes over to the flumes.
Do you know when Baby moved the Gold Coast out of the...
Anything else?
Curtis, I think you mentioned it earlier, but I didn't, I wasn't, I'm not sure I caught it. Here we're talking about the roof starting to be painted green in 91, and prior to that...
90, I think. Mineral. So, yeah, Stephen had a paint chip or a paint catalog.
He went down, took it down.
Hey, we're using this for walls and roofs.
What color is it?
Kind of a darker red. Maybe the same as what Randy and Andrew are pulling off of the Dayton Depot.
You'll get a good look at it tomorrow.
I'm just wondering where they had it parked.
It's all over the walls on the inside of the depot. Into the, you'll see it tomorrow.
But, you know, I think they mixed a lot of their paint on site from just ore that was off of the line, so their colors... And I don't think they were real interested in the color consistency, per se.
After that picture you see...
Anything else? Thank you.